The Carter School is the kind of place you don't really retire from. You become emeritus or an alumna or whatever, and your relationship to the community modulates, but it doesn't disappear. Long before we became the Jimmy and Rosalynn Carter School, when I served for a brief term as director of the what was then the Institute for Conflict Analysis and Resolution, we had a welcoming dinner for students and faculty. And I described the school as a cross between an academic department and a missionary church. So you can stop going to classes, grading papers, and attending faculty meetings without losing your faith. And the other former directors and deans who are here today, and there are a bunch of them, will testify that even after being emeritized, your membership in the community continues. I especially appreciate Alp's remarks to begin with about the current situation confronting the people of Israel and Palestine and the enormous challenge that this poses to us as human beings and as peacemakers. If Jimmy Carter were speaking to us right now, I'm sure that he'd recall that he traveled to Gaza in 2008 against the wishes of both President Bush and the government of Israel and met with the leaders of Hamas and tried to secure the release of Gilad Shalit, the captured Israeli soldier, and several human rights activists. That trip was unsuccessful. But Jimmy Carter never let the opposition of current governments or the fact that the people he was talking to had committed evil acts and might be justifiably be called terrorists stop him from trying to make peace. If he was here with us this morning, he would no doubt be urging both sides to negotiate a ceasefire and begin talking about how to save hundreds of thousands of lives rather than putting them in greater jeopardy. Jimmy's independence of mind and heart is one of the characteristics that inspires us at this school. And it's more important than ever in a period in which our own government and so many other governments are involved in wars, either direct wars or proxy wars. As pointed out by a number of recent biographies, Carter was a much better president than people used to think, when all they could seem to remember was the Iranian hostage crisis and his speech about American malaise. Carter is justly remembered for his historic role in making peace between Egypt and Israel at Camp David, and for his negotiation of the treaty that returned the Panama Canal to the people of Panama, avoiding a possible invasion of that country, which had been threatened if the treaty were not arrived. His work for human rights, which was welcomed especially by citizens of Latin America and Africa, but elsewhere too, is also memorable. In fact, I have to read you that there's a wonderful paragraph in Jonathan Alter's biography of Carter entitled His Very Best, good book, that summarizes a great deal about Carter's personal style as well as his political beliefs. So I thought I'd read this to you. It's because it's fun. Quote, he was a disciplined and incorruptible president, equipped with a sharp, omnivorous mind, a calm and adult president, dependable in a crisis, a friendless president who in 1976 primaries had defeated or alienated a good portion of the Democratic Party, a stubborn and acerbic president, never demeaning but sometimes cold, a non-ideological president who worshipped science along with God and saw governing as a series of engineering problems, an austere, even Spartan president out of sync with American consumer culture, a focused president whose diamond-cutter attention to detail brought ridicule, but also historic results, a charming president in small groups and when speaking off the cuff, but awkward in front of a teleprompter, and often allergic to small talk and to offering a simple thank you. An insular, all-business president who seemed sometimes to prefer humanity to human beings, but prayed for the strength to do better. That's a wonderful, objective picture of Carter, who was a very good president in some ways, in many ways, but his work for peace after leaving office was, that's unparalleled in American history, except maybe for John Quincy Adams, who became a congressman after he was president so that he could fight against the slave system and oppose the Mexican War. I want to say a little bit more about that work of his in a minute, but for now, let me emphasize. It evolved from missions on behalf of existing U.S. governments to missions not sponsored and even opposed by later presidents and secretaries of state. And by 2010, Carter's independence had matured to the point that he could note that the U.S. had enjoyed only 16 years of complete peace since 1776, and he could state, our country has been the foremost warlike nation on earth. Our school has been happy to cooperate with federal and state agencies on a wide variety of peacemaking and peacebuilding projects around the world. But like Jimmy Carter, we are not afraid to criticize the powers that be, and we are determined to maintain our independence of thought and action. So independence is one hallmark of Jimmy Carter's work. Another source of inspiration is his faith that skilled peacemakers can help solve the problems that produce serious conflict, even when the conflicting parties themselves have acted violently and aggressively. Jimmy and Rosalynn simply refuse to divide the world into good actors and bad actors and to justify wars or other acts of violence on the basis that bad actors are evil and that any negotiation with them would be tantamount to rewarding evil. As president, Carter knew quite well that General Torrijos of Panama was a dictator who had overthrown an elected government and then thrown a bunch of his political opponents into jail. And that did not prevent him from negotiating a Panama Canal Treaty and avoiding a possible military intervention in Panama. Similarly, after leaving office, he understood that figures that he worked with, like Khaled Mishal of Hamas, Kim Il-sung of North Korea, Raul Cedras of Haiti, Charles Taylor of Liberia, had all committed atrocities against both outsiders and even their own people. But he understood that multiplying acts of violence against their movements with inevitable damage to civilians and other parties was not the answer. As a result, his work after leaving office picked up where the Camp David negotiations had left off. In 1991, he opposed the first Persian Gulf War, arguing that it would very likely make a further war with Iraq inevitable, which of course it did, and he opposed that war as well. His intervention in Haiti in 1994 averted an invasion of that island that the Clinton administration was threatening to undertake. His work in Liberia helped end the civil war there, even though it involved working with Charles Taylor. Rosalynn Carter explained all this by stating that Jimmy did not believe that anyone, even those dubbed bad actors, was irredeemable, that everyone might be a possible partner for peace. I've mentioned his independence of mind and his faith in the possibilities of redemption, reconciliation, sources that inspire us. But now I want to mention a third source that in some ways is at least as important. His and Rosalynn's focus on eliminating the systemic sources of violence, structural violence, and doing what people today call peace building. In this respect, Rosalynn can be considered the primary source of inspiration in many ways, since she was the one to call her husband's attention to the fact that direct violence is often the product of structural violence and also produces structural violence. Galtung Johan, one of our great teachers in this field, wrote about structural violence in the 60s, pointing out that structural violence and direct violence reproduce each other. And that therefore, if you want to get to the state that he called positive peace, it would be necessary to reconstruct the systems that were generating violence, not simply negotiate a temporary peace or help to people to understand each other better. System change was what was necessary. And as a result of that, by that conviction, Rosalynn called Jimmy's attention to the women's rights issue, as a result of which he appointed more women to the federal bench than any president in history before that, and made it possible, as Ruth Bader Ginsburg later recognized, for her to advance to the Supreme Court. Rosalynn convinced Jimmy that mental illness should be treated like any other illness for public policy purposes, also for the first time. Rosalynn convinced Jimmy that there was no rational basis for any policy based on revenge, and that therefore the death penalty was unnecessary and immoral, and Jimmy, who had always previously believed in the death penalty, changed his mind. Together, after Jimmy left office, the Carters decided that the curse of political violence around the world could only be lifted by changes in the political, social, and ecological conditions that generate violence. And so they became pioneers in the fields of election monitoring, human rights, public health, home building, environmental policy, and other structural reforms that promised to eliminate at least some of the basic causes of political violence. In some ways, they were way ahead of their time. For example, Carter was the first president to recognize and take seriously the problem of global warming. His and Rosalynn's work for Habitat for Humanity created more than a million homes, affordable or free, worldwide. And their work in ridding Africa of the guinea worm disease saved probably millions. In other ways, some of us would say that Jimmy Carter's thinking remained too conventional to permit him to identify other systemic causes of violence. For example, he never developed much understanding of the structural problems of late industrial capitalism or the dangers of an overgrown military-industrial complex. Nor, as a former naval officer and president of the U.S., did he clearly identify the nation's role as an empire as a potent source of violence by and against this country. Indeed, he seems to have thought in certain ways he could reverse the bad effects of empire by his own actions, such as returning the Panama Canal and recognizing China and opposing various proposals, which he did, to intervene militarily abroad. That didn't stop him from shipping intermediate-range missiles to Europe or aiding in Afghanistan the forces that would later become the Taliban in order to mess the Russians up. Even so, Jimmy never stopped growing and questioning, never. In 2010, when the Supreme Court issued its Citizens United decision, basically granting wealthy people and corporations the unlimited right to make political campaign contributions, Carter decried the decision and said, "This is turning American society into an oligarchy," and then predicted that that sort of inequality would be a long-term cause of trouble. Well, he couldn't see everything or analyze everything, so it falls to us to decide how to transform social and political institutions that have produced bitter internal conflicts in this country, as well as bellicose policies towards other peoples and other nations. I've only touched on the ways that Carter's work influences our own. There'll be other people in the next day or two to do much more than that. But we are proud to bear their name. Our duty, in any case, our mission seems clear. It's to build on the Carter's work to create a world that enjoys the benefits of both negative and positive peace. Negative peace means an absence of direct violence, and we could use a lot more of that, for sure. Positive peace means the creation of valued relationships that eliminate structural violence. So in closing, I want to state my repeated hope and prayer that the situation is now causing infinite pain and turmoil in the Middle East and in Ukraine will be resolved soon. In my view, which is not shared necessarily by all of my colleagues or by the school, three steps are required. First, a ceasefire. Second, peaceful negotiation. Third, an agreement on how to reconstruct the political and social systems that have generated these ghastly wars. The Carters understood well that desires for revenge, for punitive justice, and for victory, which are totally understandable in human terms, also stand in the way of achieving the goal of positive peace. It's not easy to help ourselves and others to appreciate the need to control these impulses in order to escape, but we have to in order to escape the cycle of violence. Under current circumstances, and under many circumstances, since I'm coming to the school and I'll work with people dedicated to peace, peace building often means swimming against the stream. It certainly does today. Nevertheless, I can promise you that despite these difficulties, we will not abandon the struggle for positive peace. Thank you very much.